This is Earl Nightingale.
Imagine that you're seated in a theater looking at the curtain which hides the blank screen as you wait for the feature picture to begin. What will this picture do for you? How will it affect you? What impact will it have on your life? Will you feel moved, perhaps even to tears? Will you laugh at a comedy or feel terrified at the crises faced by the hero or heroine? Will you feel wonderful waves of love and compassion or surges of resentment? All these feelings will pulse through you and more. For the picture you will see is about the most fascinating person in the world, yourself. In this theater, which is in the mind and heart of each of us, you are the producer, director, writer, actor or actress, hero, and the villain. You are the film technician up in the booth, and the audience which reacts to this thrilling drama. The exciting story unfolding upon this inner screen is one which is invented every second of your life, yesterday, tomorrow, but most important, right now. You watch the image upon that screen, and you invent the image upon that screen right now. Will the story have a happy ending? Is it full of happiness and success, or sorrow and failure? The storyline is already there, and the discerning eye can tell the direction in which the story will go. But one realization can comfort you. Since you are the dramatist, the director, and the actor, you can change the story as it unfolds, now, this instant, and for your whole lifetime. It seems that you can make this a success story. You can be the hero and conquer the villain. You can make this a heartwarming story which will enrich the lives of all who know you, rather than a drab mechanical tale, a chronicle of boredom. It's all inside you. It all depends on what you do with an image you carry inside you, an image which is your most important tool for good or for ill. It all depends on you and your self-image. The self-image is your own conception of the sort of person you are. It's a product of past experiences, successes and failures, humiliations and triumphs, and the way other people react to you, especially in early childhood. From these factors and from others, you build up a picture of yourself which you believe is true. The picture may be false, and in many cases is false, but the important fact here is that you act just as if it were true. For all intents and purposes, it is true. If it's a good, healthy, successful self-image, fine, but if it can stand some improvement, you can change it for the better and start getting the kind of results such a change will bring about.
Our thoughts, habits, even our abilities must be those of the person we believe ourselves to be. We can set new limits in place of old ones, but we can't surpass the limits of our current self-image. There's a story about a Wisconsin farmer who was walking through his fields one day when he stumbled over a little glass jug in his pumpkin patch. Out of curiosity, he poked a young pumpkin through the neck of the jug, being careful not to break the vine. Then he placed his little experiment back on the ground and walked away. When harvest time came, the farmer was working his way down a row of big ripe pumpkins when he again came upon the glass jug. But this time it looked different. Picking it up, he discovered that the young pumpkin he'd poked inside now completely filled its glass prison. Having no more room, it had stopped growing. The farmer broke the jug and held in his hand a runt pumpkin, less than half the size of all the other pumpkins and exactly the shape of the jug. Well, people aren't pumpkins, but our self-image is something like that jug. It determines the size and kind of person we become. The similarity ends with the fact that we can remove our self-imposed limitations by enlarging our self-image. We form a mental picture of ourselves through experience, and we can change that picture the same way, through experience. If the actual experience we need is not available to us, we can, according to self-image psychology, create that experience synthetically. Now, scientists agree that the human nervous system is incapable of distinguishing between actual experience and the same experience imagined vividly and in complete detail. Worry is a good example of this synthetic experience. When a person worries about something, he projects himself mentally, emotionally, even physically, into a situation that hasn't even occurred. The man who worries intensely about, well, say, failure, finds himself experiencing the same reactions that accompany actual failure, feelings of anxiety, inadequacy, and humiliation, and eventually headaches and an upset stomach. As far as his mind and body are concerned, he has failed. And if he worries about it long enough, if he concentrates on failure intensely enough, he will upset himself to the extent that he will fail, and he'll get sick. Now, everything can be used in either of two ways. positively or negatively, constructively or destructively. Worry is the negative use of creative imagination. It's a negative synthetic experience. But most people apparently never realize that positive results, just as real as the negative results of worry, can be achieved through using our imagination constructively. The man who worries about failure is unwittingly defeating himself. He's feeding his mind the wrong data. If he spent the same amount of time visualizing success as he spends thinking about failure, he could reverse the process of synthetic experience. Instead of anxiety, he could develop confidence, self-assurance, poise, and a feeling of well-being would replace apprehension. By concentrating on the success he desires, by synthetically experiencing that success, he can expand his self-image into that of a person for whom success is normal, expected. Why not practice holding the self-image of the person you most want to become? This is the person you can become. Use your spare moments to concentrate on your goals and the greater success you seek. Analyze your past successes and formulate ways your success can be increased in the future. Put more into the positive use of your imagination than you ever put into its negative use, worry. You're merely reversing the same creative process. Now it's working for you instead of against you. Nobody pokes us into glass prisons beyond which we can't grow. But all too often, almost unknowingly, we set unnecessary limits for ourselves by holding a self-image that's restricted, inadequate for the full realization of our potentialities. Each of us is, at this moment, the product of all his thoughts and experiences and environment up to this point. Through thought, we can control to an almost unbelievable degree both our experience and our environment from here on. Whether or not we choose to direct our own course through life is entirely up to us. The important thing is to know that it can be done.